You know, television's come a long way since it began back in the 30s and the 40s. Today, television sets are found in almost every home, and it has an influence in almost every aspect of our daily lives. As educators, it's very important that you take notice of the fact that television plays a big role in your life and in the lives of your students. And what can television do for you as an educator? Well, the simple answer to that question is that television can help you to help your students learn. Many of you have perhaps already been exposed to instructional or educational television. Consequently, for some of you, the words instructional or educational television may have an unpleasant connotation. Some of you, on the other hand, have been fortunate enough to witness properly handled instructional television. You're fortunate in that you're well aware of what television can do for you. Commercial television helps to sell billions of dollars worth of soap, cigarettes, cars, living bras, and almost every other product imaginable every year. Thus, it should stand to reason that television can sell knowledge if it's used properly. Let's take a look at some of the things that television can do when it's used properly. Television can bring people into the classroom in person. Suppose you were teaching a course in social studies, and you wanted to point out the difference between Republicans and Democrats. Well, why not bring some popular political figure into the classroom via television and ask the question?
I'm afraid we'd have to devote the whole evening to it. But perhaps I could highlight one or two things. One, of course, is the insistence on the part of Republicans that we balance up our fiscal affairs to make sure that we're going to have a solvent country. I think, generally speaking, our friends on the other side of the aisle are prone to spend money and go in for new activities when it's rather doubtful whether or not it is good for the country and for the interests of the people, because you pile up your national debt, you pile up the interest, you pile up these staggering deficits that we have at the present time, and that spends itself in terms of higher interest rates, higher prices in the stores where people shop, and so the evil effects always fall upon the people back home. That is one real departure between the two parties. There are others, of course. I think it can be said that we still own to the gospel of Abraham Lincoln. He once said that he thought he was a conservative Republican. And I think that goes for me. I'm a guard variety Lincoln Republican. And when I say conservative, that means to conserve the values, the assets, and the resources that have been builded up in this country, and to make sure that we have a good legacy that we can transmit to those who come after. Now, we've been the beneficiaries of a tremendous inheritance in the form of a free country. And that gives point also to one more thing. The Republicans try as best they can to resist the constant incursions of the federal government into the liberties of the people. By that I mean through rule, law, and regulation to subject them to restrictions and inhibitions of one kind and another that are very definitely circumscribing their liberties at home. So we can pinpoint it there on the fiscal matter and on the matter of the liberties of the people.
Okay, thank you very much. Senator Everett Dirksen.
Of course, I might add, if you hadn't already guessed, that this is the Republican view of the difference between the parties. Along this same line, television affords us the opportunity to bring the specialist or the authority in certain areas into the classroom to supplement a course. Mrs. Mary Calderon, the founder and director of the Sex Information and Education Council, would be an important and an interesting guest in a sex education class.
Learn about it. Help it become a part of the most creative aspects of your personality instead of just something that you do in bed. That's the educational part of it, of the Sex Information and Education Council.
Right. Some of you may realize or already know that this is one aspect of the total program that we have underway. And we have asked Dr. Mary Calderon here to give us some of her views on the subject. And perhaps first, we might have her lead off with a CECUS objective, which they have called a major objective to establish man's sexuality as a health entity. Would you care to elaborate on that theme for us, Dr. Calderon?
Yes, that goes on from what I was just saying, that sex isn't just something that you do in bed. It's a most important part of your total personality structure. One of our board members, Father John Thomas, who happens to be a Jesuit, phrased it beautifully in an editorial he wrote for us called Sexuality and the Total Personality. It's a very important thing to understand that man's health includes not just his physical self, but his emotional self. The World Health Organization states that health is a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. Now, it's obvious that this part of our lives starts with birth, continues on through childhood and through adult life until the day we die, our sexuality. And so, as far as I'm concerned, and as far as those of us in CECUS is concerned, and we are psychiatrists and obstetricians and gynecologists and marriage counselors and sociologists, all disciplines, of course, teachers, college presidents, as far as we're concerned, sex is a part of life, a part of man's total health in the positive sense of the word.
Well, would you care to elaborate on what you mean by a healthy sexuality?
Yes. How do you use this great, powerful force in your life? Do you use it, not talking about you. How do you use it? How does one use it? Do we use it positively? Do we use it creatively? Do we use it non-exploitively? Do we use it simply to get something we want out of life or out of somebody else? Or do we use it as a weapon of revenge or a bribe or a punishment? There are all sorts of ways of using sex, you see. Now, obviously, a healthy way is not necessarily a way that denies sex. On the contrary, I think the most healthy way of using sex is affirmatively, to affirm sex as a positive force. But, of course, you have to do what you do with any other of your faculties, use it creatively for yourself and for the other.
Another thing to remember about television is that it can bring events into the classroom as they happen. If an important event is taking place, why not let the students witness it? A satellite launch means more if it's viewed than if it's read about.
Telemetry quality. Mercury capsule.
Go. 7K body radio, HF.
Roger, loud and clear. How many?
Minus 40.
Status check, pressurization. Locks tanking.
Have a blinking high level light.
You are go. Motor systems.
Go.
Range operations.
Enter.
Mercury capsule.
Go.
All pre-start panel lights are correct. The ready light is on. Eject Mercury umbilical.
Godspeed, John Glenn. 5, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Roger, the clock is operating. We're underway.
You're loud and clear.
Roger, we're programming and roll okay. A little bumpy along about here.
Roger. Stand by for 20 seconds.
Roger.
2, 1, mark.
Roger, backup clock is started. Fuel 102, 101, oxygen 78, 100, amps 27.
Roger, loud and clear, flight path is good, 6-9.
Roger, check's okay. Mine was 7-0 on your mark. Have some vibration area coming up here now.
Roger, reading you loud and clear, John.
Roger, coming into high Q a little bit. That little contrail went by the window or something there.
Roger.
Fuel 102, 101, oxygen 78, 101, amps 24, still okay. Smoothing out some now, getting out of the vibration area.
Roger, you feel max Q, flight path is...
Roger, feel feels good through max Q and smoothing out real fine. Sky looking very dark outside. Cabin pressure is holding at 6-1, okay.
Roger, cabin pressure holding at 6-1.
Roger, I've had some oscillations, but they seem to be damping out okay now. Coming up on 2 minutes. These are building to 6.
Roger, reading you loud and clear. Flight path looks good. Pitch 25, stand by for stir.
Roger, Pico. Back to 1 1/4, the tower fired. I could not see the tower go. I saw the smoke go by the window.
Yeah, we confirm staging on DM.
Roger. There the tower went right then. Have the tower in sight, way out. Could see the tower go. Edison Tower is green.
Roger.
1.5 G's.
Friendship 7, Bermuda has you.
Roger, Bermuda, stand by. This is Friendship 7.
Oh, Roger, reading you loud and clear, 7. Cape is go. We're standing by for you.
Roger, Cape is go and I am go. Our capsule is in good shape.
Roger, 20 seconds to Seco.
Roger. Indicating 6 G's. Seco. Plaza grades fired, okay.
Roger, Steph.
Roger, 0 G and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous.
Roger, turnaround has started.
Roger, capsule turning around, and I could see the booster during turnaround just a couple of hundred yards behind me. It was beautiful.
Roger, 7, you have a go at least 7 orbits.
Of course, there are other types of programming. The documentary, for instance. Now, it takes a great deal of time and effort to put together a good documentary program. The average teacher couldn't afford to spend a great deal of the researching time that a certain topic would need in addition to her regular teaching duties. Well, why not use a documentary program to supplement a course if it can be used effectively?
The settlement of Illinois started at the tip of the arrow, the southern part of the state, and gradually moved northward. One of the chief factors which brought this about was river transportation, the Ohio on the east and the Mississippi on the west. And where they converged at the very tip of the arrow, at Cairo, made that a location as important as the intersection of two main highways. In those early days, Cairo became known as the busiest inland seaport in the nation. It was not unusual for 100 boats a day to dock at Cairo. And Ohio Street, which ran parallel to the Ohio River, was one of the busiest in Illinois. And, one might add, one of the most exciting. Entertainment of every variety was wild and rowdy. If you could take it, they could dish it out. And when the river rats hit the dock, the jubilant cry was, "Meet you at 713 Ohio Street."
One of the most popular types of programming on commercial television is the drama. It's popular on commercial television because it holds the interest of the audience. Well, if it can hold the interest and sell the product on commercial television, it can probably hold the interest of your students and maybe sell your product. The study of history is much more meaningful if it's presented in dramatic form.
Thank you. got to him just as keenly as you want us out of here. That's back to the ball. And the point of power.
God save us, Captain Preston.
The television camera itself is an excellent aid in teaching. When equipped with a close-up lens, the entire class is able to see detail which would be impossible in a conventional classroom. Now, using the close-up lens, every student has a front row seat, as objects can be magnified many times their normal size. A biology lesson can be greatly enhanced with close-up views of different things which most people would not otherwise see in this magnified state. Snakes and iguanas are something that most people like to look at only from a safe distance. Well, the television camera offers you a safe, close-up view. Television today is not only helping the teacher in the learning process. It's also helping to alleviate the problems of understaffed schools. By using television, a carefully prepared lesson or series of lessons can be viewed by an unlimited number of classrooms. Using film or videotape recordings, an entire course can be saved and used over and over again. Thus, a school with no physics course might be able to offer a physics course using television. Well, the question might be asked, which is better, a television course or no physics course? The answer is obvious. By using a television course, the school also quite frequently has the services of a teacher who has been proven to be an effective communicator and at a fraction of what it would cost to hire that same teacher. In preparing a television lesson, the teacher has at his disposal all the devices found in the classroom and many others. He can use slides, he can use films, he can use charts, graphs, opaque projectors, music, and other audiovisual aids found in a television studio. And he also has at his disposal an art shop, which can supply other visuals to supplement a lesson. This next videotape segment is from an instructional television series called Wonder Why. Notice how the television teacher uses audiovisual devices to enhance the lesson, and how she seems to be directing the lesson at you, individually.
Present Wonder Why, a course of discovery in social studies with Cecilia McElroy.
Hello, boys and girls. It's so beautiful here today that I just had to get outside for a while. The weather is so warm and the sun is shining so brightly. I just love to be out in this kind of weather. It's so pretty out that earlier I decided to go for a walk. And you know, the grass was so green and I looked around and there wasn't a cloud in sight. I enjoy looking at the trees when all the leaves are beginning to change, like they are now. And I saw a lake that was nearby. I enjoy looking at the lake, too. Someone's calling me on my radio phone. Just a minute. Hello?
Hello, Mrs. McElroy. This is Beppo.
Well, hello, Beppo. Earlier he told me that he and Nars were going to Portland, Oregon to play in a football game. How's the football game coming along, Beppo?
Oh, Mrs. McElroy. That's what I'm calling about. It's just awful. The game has been delayed because of rain. Norris and I were ready to play, but gee whiz, it's been raining the whole time we've been here. If they decide to play the game, would it be okay if we stay? I'll probably be late for the telecast.
That's okay, Beppo, because the telecast has already started, and you're already late, so I don't mind if you stay a little longer.
Good. Oh, Mrs. McElroy, Norris and I do want to play in the football game, but we're also anxious to get home now. What causes all this rain? I know that in Omaha, where we'll play our next football game, there isn't nearly as much rain as we're having here in Portland. Mrs. McElroy, I wonder what makes climate so different.
Climate, Beppo? Don't you mean weather? You know, there is a difference.
There is? You mean there is a difference between weather and climate?
Yes, Beppo, a big one.
Well, I think while we're waiting for the rain to stop, Norris and I'd better get to know the difference between climate and weather. We'll see you after we play in the football game, if it ever stops raining long enough.
Okay, but don't be too disappointed if it doesn't stop raining, because you and Norris can always go back to Portland another time. Goodbye. You know, it is too bad that the weather in Portland couldn't be as pretty as it is here. You know, at times, Beppo was confused between the meaning of weather and climate. He and Norris decided they should find out what the differences are. So let's find out, too, and we'll start by discovering something interesting about weather and climate. The study of weather and climate is one of the oldest sciences in the world.
There's still another example of the use of television. Let's suppose you were a geography teacher teaching about Germany. Well, it would probably be difficult to tell your class much about the people of the country unless you had lived there. And it would also probably be impossible in most cases to bring a person from Germany into the classroom to answer questions from students. It can be done with instructional television.
This is Lisa Wells, who now resides with her husband and family in Anna, Illinois. Mrs. Wells will be discussing her native country, Germany, with students from West Frankfort High School on Ask Me About Germany. Now your series host, Richard Qualls.
Ask Me About is a program of questions and answers, facts and opinions. In the next 30 minutes, we hope that you will have a better understanding of a country and its people different from us. Now, you have met our guest for today, Mrs. Lisa Wells from Anna, a citizen of the United States now, but originally from Germany. Let's meet the young people who will be asking the questions, and they're from the West Frankfort High School. And would you introduce yourself, please?
I'm Pat Riva, a junior.
Iris Walker, senior.
Sally Mitchell, a junior.
Steve Galula, a junior.
Thank you. Before we begin the questioning, let me tell you something about Germany. Well, despite a warlike past, Germany has made many contributions to Western civilization, both in the arts and in science. Although politically split since 1945, the country is still culturally and geographically united. The German people love music, dancing, and the outdoors. They are noted for their excellent cooking. Today, remote mountain villages preserve some of the old ways of dress and life. Germany is not rich in natural resources, but through hard work, skill, and technical education, the people have produced great wealth from their limited raw materials. The Ruhr Valley is the site of a world-famous industrial complex. Despite poor soil, scientific farming and the use of fertilizer result in good yields. Potatoes are an important crop, and from their grapes, delicious German wines are produced. The modern split in political ideology has resulted in two different systems of education. East German schools teach communism, while the Western sector teaches democracy. Now let's begin the questioning. I'd like to remind our viewers that our guest for today is a citizen of the United States, and her answers do not represent the official government of Germany or the United States. The questions will be in the area of political, cultural, and economic affairs. And Iris, I believe you have the first question for us.
How long have you been in the United States?
I came to the United States almost 6 years ago. And I came with my husband and one son, who was born in Germany. I met my husband while he was serving his army in Germany, and he was a dentist. So I met him. I really wanted to practice my English on him since I had just come back from England, and I just wanted to see if I could still speak it well enough. So I was practicing on him, and it turned out to be a marriage in the end.
As you've seen here, television has a tremendous range of possible uses. It may be used as a simple magnification device within the classroom. It may provide the teacher with supplementary materials, or it may form the basis for an entire course. One rule to remember is that unless television is used to do something which cannot be done in the classroom, it's not being used properly. The goal of instructional television is not to take the place of the classroom teacher. It's a tool for the teacher to use. It's a device which must be used, not because it is a device, but because it can be helpful in the learning process. It can entertain and it can educate. It's best used when it does both. There are many other uses of instructional television which we've not covered here. We've really only scratched the surface in this program. The imagination of the classroom teacher working as a team with the television teacher offers almost unlimited possibilities for the use of instructional television. We believe that television can help in providing a better education for everyone.